The following production is part of the We Be Geeks podcast collective.
All this has happened before.
Hey kids, Townsend Coleman here, the voice of Michelangelo from the original Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Tom Kane, this is the voice of Yoda on Star Wars.
Hey yo, it's Wopat, and a big yee-haw to you all. I used to be Luke too.
Hi, my name is Oli Shoshan. I play Jedi Master Shakti.
Hi, Butch Patrick here, Eddie Munster.
Hi, this is Jim.
Hi, this is Bill Farmer. You're listening to the Neverland Podcast.
Welcome to Neverland, to Disney and beyond.
And it will all happen again.
And now your head lost boy, the Spider-Pan.
Walk on the eyes, it is Pan.
Jeremy.
Hooray for Captain Pan!
Hey there, friends. Take your pixie out of your pocket. Sprinkle some of that pixie dust around. Think that happiest thought and let's fly away to Neverland. Yeah, as the introduction told you, I am Jeremy. I am your head lost boy. I am the Spider-Pan. And at the time of the recording you're about to hear, I had not completed the game which we are about to speak of. I mean, when we're talking about a gaming event, this is, of course, we're not necessarily being non-Disney with this episode. There is a Disney connection we're going to get into, but Final Fantasy VII, the remake, came out on April the 10th. I've had an opportunity to play it, and as of the time that I'm recording right now, I have finished. I won't say completed because there's a completely different thing in PlayStation lingo of completing a game, and that would be to have the Platinum Trophy, which I might be able to get. I'm going to give it a shot. Where I am at, though, right now, and I want to let you know, I am going to play through the game again. I've put it on easy mode because I did it on a regular mode before, and apparently there is no achievement for specifically doing it on normal, but on doing it on easy, I can speed through the story and just level up my characters and my materia and stuff like that, get an achievement for getting everybody to level 50 because there's an experience bonus for having completed the game. And then after this run through, I'm going to try to do it on a harder difficulty, the hardest difficulty, hard, which will be interesting because I'm not allowed to use any items and I don't know how I'm supposed to refill my magic meter because I can't use items and they say the benches and rest areas won't refill my magic. That's a whole other issue. But here's what I want to get to. If you visit the YouTube channel for Neverland to Disney and Beyond or even the Spider-Pan, I am posting some videos of just far over in the Neverland channel. There's some, if you just want to see some of the story elements, I will have that over there. I have some gameplay footage that I'm going to be posting up on the Spider-Pan channel. Also, I am live streaming. I don't really have a schedule for this, but I'm live streaming my playthrough on Easy right now on the Neverland channel, which I'm kind of just, whenever I play, I'm just live streaming. If I scheduled, I'd probably get more of you to be able to view. But, you know, if you would like to see me play it through on Easy, because it's kind of a quicker speed through, I'm doing that in about an hour or 2 hours at a time, however long I have to just sit and play. So that'll be on the Neverland channel as well. So if you want to go and check those out, that'd be great. Don't forget to support me on Patreon. That helps me continue to do what I do here, making the podcast, making the videos. It does cost me, and I appreciate your help, especially now as many of you probably remember that I've mentioned I have been working from home since mid-March. Well, I got handed the news this week. I'm now furloughed, so I've had to file for unemployment. I am joining so many of you out there in, not currently working, which does give me more time to sit and play games. So when I got furloughed, I just took advantage of the time and I started playing the heck out of this game because I suddenly found myself with a lot more time. And also making some videos, which I've got a backlog of gaming videos because, one of the things I wanted to have as part of this podcast is video games, nostalgia and even some modern stuff, and this game is a little bit of both. When this game came out 23 years ago, it was an event, and anyone who was playing games or had a PlayStation back at the time, even if you didn't have a PlayStation, you were aware of Final Fantasy VII when it came out. It was a big deal, and the remake has also been a pretty big deal, and so we're going to talk about that today. Oh, and I do have a guest, and well, since I've said everything I need to say, let me turn it over to a previously recorded conversation I have with our guest, which hopefully most of you will remember. And if you don't remember him, you're going to get to know him. But here we go.
Thank you.
Okay, so it's been a while since we've talked to you, but you run Divine Image Works. Of course, you're a sergeant in the New Jersey Police Department, so you're out having to deal with some of this COVID stuff, I bet, a little bit.
Yeah, a little bit. It's definitely some strange times we're living in right now.
As it says in one of the Discworld books, may you be cursed by living in interesting times. Tim Devine, who, you of course are known mainly, I think, for a lot of your Disney photography, which you had a separate website other than Divine Image Works, didn't you, for the Disney photography?
Yeah, my Disney photography website's called The Magic in Pixels. It's still up, but admittedly, it's starting to grow some cobwebs on it. There's this funny thing about having kids. Your time that you have, just goes goodbye. So between the law enforcement world, my family and fatherly commitments, paying attention to my wife too, happy wife, happy life.
Yeah.
And my professional photography business now, Divine Image Works, there's really not a whole lot of time to be, sharing Jungle Cruise pictures and stuff like that. Not that I don't still love the place and I still have my joy when I'm there and I still take my camera and act like business as usual when I'm on vacation. Unfortunately, right now, I haven't had a lot of time to edit the pictures and post them and share them and really get involved in some of the Facebook groups that have come along and things like that. So I'm a little negligent on that respect, but I think I have a good enough alibi. Maybe.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, I understand how that works, except for I don't have any kids to get in my way, but I still don't hardly get anything done. Although I have a lot more furlough time now that I'm furloughed from work, so if anybody goes to the YouTube channel from either Neverland to Disney and Beyond or the YouTube channel The Spider Pan, I'm posting a lot of new video up there, and I have nothing better to do besides play video games and post videos of me playing video games. Which
nice. I can't say I don't envy you. I mean, you and I know, but maybe the audience doesn't so much, but I'm a pretty prolific PlayStation fan myself. Been playing video games my whole life. I've had a little bit of extra time off of work right now because we're running a little bit of a reduced manpower for obvious reasons due to the COVID. So before I got really busy with my Image Works business this week, I was putting quite a bit of time into my PlayStation, and then my wife decided, well, you're going to be home. She's a school teacher working from home. She figured, well, maybe it'd be a good idea if we clean out the garage and the shed. And let's get on the basement and, all that honeydew list stuff that I've been kind of conveniently forgetting to do.
I've had a lot more time to actually I'm unpacking into the house now, finally. So my office is actually starting to look like it did back in the old apartment. I've got a lot of my knickknacks out now. So, I've had some time. But some time definitely playing some games, which is kind of our focal point here. And I found a good Disney connection. But there are definitely, if we look at an overall series of games, there's definitely some series that are always the most iconic. I mean, what is one of your favorite series of games?
Assassin's Creed?
I played the first one and I got frustrated. And I finished it, but I was like, I'm never playing these again.
Yeah, Assassin's Creed is, it took me, I was very, very late to the party when I jumped in on that one. But man, do I feel like I missed out on something. Now, obviously, being a PlayStation guy, there's no Halo in my life, so you got to go Nathan Drake.
Yes, the Uncharted series. Love those
and
as well.
And they're all free on PlayStation Plus this month, by the way.
Oh, well, every one of them. I'm on the PlayStation now, so I get like a streaming service, so I get to play a lot of things. But every once in a while, you have either a series or an event that happens that you're like, okay, forget about it. Normally a game comes out, I'll give it 3 or 4 years. When the price drops down, I can get it for under $20. Then that's when I buy it. But there are occasional games I buy outright. And there are certain games I know throughout the history of my life of being able to have my own income that it was an event when that game came out that I had to reserve it. One of them, of course, being the old Maximum Carnage on the Super Nintendo.
Oh, man, I remember that, yeah.
I'm a Spider-Man junkie. I had to get it. I had collected the entire comic series. So I remember and when it would get delayed, I'd be freaked out. But, one of the events that I didn't even know anything about it because it was a sequel. But Metal Gear Solid. I remember when that first came out on the PlayStation, that was like an event. There was so much anticipation in every gaming magazine that I was like, I don't understand what this game is, but I'm buying it the day it comes out.
You want a true confession?
Hmm.
That's the only Metal Gear I've ever played and beaten.
Me too. No, I did play the second one. I played the second one, but I was kind of irritated with it because you end up playing as that Raiden guy. And then I started to play the third one, and I was like, you know, I just don't feel it anymore. I kind of lost interest. I should probably come back to it because I hear the fourth one was good, and the fifth one apparently is pretty phenomenal.
Well, we got them for free on the PlayStation Plus. It was one of the free games a few years ago, so I really have no excuse to not play it other than just haven't played it.
Just haven't done it. So, yeah, there's definitely those events, and I remember back in 1997. Now, I had played a Final Fantasy game before. My best friend's sister's boyfriend was big into Final Fantasy games. Yeah, I know, you have to count it out. But he loaned me Secret of Mana and I think Final Fantasy II. And I didn't finish either of them, but I Final Fantasy II, I don't remember what number that would have been in Japan, but it was at least the first one that was on the Super Nintendo, and we called it 2, I believe. And the only thing I remember, it was Cecil the Death Knight, that at the beginning of it, you're going and you're under orders from like this Emperor King guy to go into this temple and grab these crystals. Now, after he does that, he realizes, I'm working for the bad guy. This guy's nuts. And so he defects. And he's trying to go and redeem himself because he didn't realize all the horrible things he had done in his life as a Death Knight. And it was a pretty good story, but that's all I remember, except for there were airships. And I said, well, this is really neat. So then when they start talking Final Fantasy VII and all the gaming magazines, and there was going to be this, once again, it's a gaming event. It's not just a release. It's like a Harry Potter book is coming out. It's the only way I can describe this. There are some series of games, almost like every Legend of Zelda game. I love those. I haven't played every single Legend of Zelda game, but I love those. But when a Metal Gear Solid game's out, when a Super Mario game comes out, when a Legend of Zelda game comes out, or when a new Final Fantasy, especially Final Fantasy VII, there was so much anticipation because the stuff they were showing us, there was full motion video graphics that were going to move right into pre-rendered backgrounds in a very cinematic fashion. We'd never seen anything like that before. And so when that dropped in 1997, that was one of the ones I was like, okay, I don't know. I've only played a little bit of Final Fantasy, but I have to buy this.
What I remember, I was sitting in the computer lab in college between a couple of my classes, and I was just looking up video game websites because I was, frankly, bored out of my mind. I didn't have any real work to do. And Final Fantasy VII came across. It was probably on one of the old IGN websites.
Mm.
Far back as this is going to go. And I mean, IGN's still going strong, obviously, but this is back when it was in its infancy. And I remember seeing the cutscene of approaching I guess the casino area. And or the Wall Market or whatever.
Wall Market, yeah.
Wall Market. And I was like, holy smokerolies. I don't know what this is, but I've never seen this before, and this is freaking cool.
Yeah.
So I went to my next class, finished it, and then went right to the local, it was probably still EB Games or something like that. No, wow. You know what? It might even have still been Electronic Boutique.
Wow, and yeah.
I snatched up a copy in, what was it, three or four? It was three or four discs.
Four discs.
It was a big fat double jewel case. Mm. And went home and fired that puppy up. And quite frankly, I had never really had any interest in turn-based games.
Yeah.
I'm not into strategy games. There's no Command and Conquer in my life or any of those other kind of games. And I was hooked, man. I was like, this is cool. You know, you have the very rudimentary polygon characters on
yeah.
CGI looking backgrounds, and none of it really should have made any sense.
Mm-hmm.
But it was just like you said, this was an event. This was a happening. This was, you know, Square Enix had shown what the PlayStation, the old PlayStation, could pull off. Mm-hmm. You know, with a little bit of trickery and some talented programming, and I was hooked, man. And so it's after Final Fantasy VII, which I didn't finish, I'll admit it.
I didn't either. I have reasons.
You know, 55 hours into it, and I'm still not done. I'm like, all right, cool. I think I get it now. we're good. But then, you know, they came out with Parasite Eve. Remember Parasite Eve?
Yeah, I remember buying that one. I don't think I got very far in it.
Oh, I finished that. I beat that one so many times. I could probably play it now and finish it again. That one was pretty awesome. But that was more of an action cinematic role-playing game as opposed to a traditional JRPG.
Yeah.
But then I started getting into some of the RPGs. I never really got into a whole lot of like the really fantastical ones. You know, I bought The Witcher 3 finally last week.
That'll suck up your life.
I bought it because I think it was like $11 or something on the PlayStation Network. So
yeah.
I was like, all right, I want to see what the hype's all about. Because, like I said, when we opened the show, I'm into more action type games as opposed to like the grinding and the leveling and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, I'm an Uncharted guy. I'm an Assassin's Creed. I'm a Tomb Raider. You know, I used to play sports games religiously. I actually played all 162 games on World Series Baseball on the Sega Genesis. I played the whole season. Go Phillies.
Go Royals. Who? Yeah, I know.
We were good just a few years ago.
You were, and then what happened?
That's what happens around here. We have a good team, and all of a sudden everybody buys our players away from us.
Listen, you listen. You're still basking in reflected glory right now. So get it over with. I'm an Eagles fan. Come on,
Chiefs. Come
on. How about those Chiefs?
the time's yours. That was not bad, right? But now that I'm older and I don't really have the attention span to just sit there and play, you know, ball game after ball game after ball game. Even though I buy them every. My kids play them like crazy right now. You know, I've been playing the more story-based, the more character-driven type games. So, you know, like I said, Assassin's Creed, Tomb Raider. A Tomb Raider, basically, now that it's been rebooted, is Uncharted with a woman, for the most part. But with a little bit more exploration involved. So it's not a completely fair comparison. But, you know, Nathan Drake and Lara Croft, if Sony really had some creative irons in the fire, they'd find a way to do a mashup of those two. I mean, how cool would that be?
Well, I've seen a death battle video, I think, that Screw Attack perhaps had made, and Lara Croft won because she gets to have ridiculous things happen to her in games that she can fall of stuff that is supposed to kill her. And see, that's why the original Tomb Raiders, the controls to me were kind of rough, and I never quite got through any of it. I played the first two. And then when they rebooted it, the design, I looked at her, and I was like, this, for some reason, Lara Croft doesn't look tough anymore. And I can't believe that she does the stuff. And I see footage where she falls and she gets impaled on the thing. She falls off this other stuff. I'm like, she looks like she would break. And even when they made that movie, I looked at the actress. I'm like, this scrawny little thing. At least Angelina Jolie somehow or another looked tough as Lara Croft. I could believe she was going to kick some butt. But that Vikander girl, and even the way she looks in the new games, I look at her and says, you don't look like Lara Croft that I'm familiar with that looked tough. That she was going to do this.
She's pretty hardcore once you start getting into it.
Once you start playing.
She starts off the first Tomb Raider pretty vulnerable and very timid and, you know, not really sure. And then, you know, once she whacks her first dude and gets over the shock of whacking a dude, then it's just like all bets are off, man. Like, let's go thin out the herd a little bit.
Yeah. I should play the reboots because getting a good boost. Because part of the problem that drove me crazy with the original Tomb Raider games is falling off of something into water, and dang it, now I got to start this 5-minute climb again because I missed one jump. It was so unforgiving.
These new ones play very much like Uncharted,
and I would love that.
Well, like I said, with a little bit more exploration, a little bit more open world kind of stuff. But the original Tomb Raider reboot, I mean, God, I can't even believe how many years old the reboot is now.
Yeah,
you know. And then, you know, and then Shadow the Tomb Raider. That was the first game I played when I got my new 65-inch HDR 4K TV. And you start off on a snowy mountain peak, and you could actually discern individual flakes of snow on the ground. And they had the glint from the reflections, and it was just so the visual effects were so well done. And then, of course, you know, Shadow the Tomb Raider, which is the most recent one. I started playing into that. That was a tour de force. And then a whole bunch of other games came out. And I was just like, you know what? My ADD is going to kill me here. So I'm going to go try something else. But I'll go back to it, I promise.
Yeah.
I never went back to it.
Well, you're like me. What from the Brian from The Real Brian Shows, he refers to it as being a polygamous gamer. we get distracted because if we might get stuck a little bit and like, well, I do want to go play this. But I do have those occasions where a game is so mind consuming that that is all I can think about playing.
And that's L.A. Noir for me.
That was fun. That one was fun. I need to play it on the PS4 because I hear they changed the interrogation system where it makes a little bit more sense. So, because I had a hard time with the interrogation in the PS3.
Instead of truth, lie, doubt, they changed it to good cop, bad cop.
Right.
I think accuse or something like that. It actually does make a little bit more sense, even though Aaron Staton's voice acting is still completely all over the place. So, you know, the lady can be telling you the truth, and you go with the fact she's telling you the truth, and he still starts screaming at her.
I think you know it, and he starts doing this pointing at his notepad, and yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't work like that in my real job.
Right. But going back to like with Final Fantasy, now we had seen pre-rendered backgrounds. I mean, one of the first PlayStation games I remember playing other than Mortal Kombat games was Resident Evil. Yes. Which is probably why I couldn't get into Parasite Eve, because I was expecting it to be a little closer to Resident Evil in game style, and it was really different, and I couldn't quite get into it. But Resident Evil gave you pre-rendered backgrounds, but they didn't move. So then Final Fantasy VII comes out, and suddenly the pre-rendered background actually came from a full-motion video, and you could, the map areas that they would make that were pre-rendered were huge, so you could actually move around inside of their pre-rendered background, even though the polygonal characters, I always thought they looked like Popeye, because like Cloud would have big shoulders, these skinny little bicep arms, and then they would fluff out his hands, but then you get into a combat screen, and then the characters look so much better all of a sudden. That was one thing that was so funny about that, but if still... Now, here's my thing, is I'm like you, I prefer some action to my games. I don't like to just, you know, tell it, okay, I want to attack, click. And having random encounters where I couldn't see a fight coming, but I'm interested in the story and I want to get to the next part of the story and I'm excited about it. And then I feel like I get interrupted by these battles that took way too long because I was sitting there telling attack, no, okay, let's use magic. Oh, I guess I better use a potion. And doing that, because the only strategy stuff I had done really was Command and Conquer. I did kind of like that. That was fun, but it was mainly fun when you got to play against other people. Yeah. But I get frustrated with constantly having to deal with the random battles that I didn't find to be that interesting. Although the animations and the graphics, the summons were amazing in that. But it got frustrating. But I really, the thing with it is, this was the beginning of, in the PlayStation era, really, other than Legend of Zelda, I mean Super Nintendo, Link to the Past, games suddenly started taking on this more story-driven narrative. And the story was great. The characters were so compelling that I really loved the character Aerith. She was such a great character. And then when I saw in gaming magazines what was going to happen to her, and I won't say because I don't want to spoil, just in case there's somebody out there who doesn't know about this. When I found out what was going to happen to her, I lost motivation. That broke me. I was like, no, you can't do this to me. And then I found, you know, people online had been doing searches to alter the course of it. It's like, okay, maybe if we do something different, we can change this. And it became as much as the Lara Croft nude code, talking about Tomb Raider, the Lara Croft nude code that never existed, but everybody just wanted it to exist, which is the same thing with what happens.
Yeah, that one, never really got into that one. It just seemed a little odd.
Yeah, it was the early days of the internet that there was like weird things in games that like, oh no, this thing totally exists. It was almost kind of like Spanish Fly. Everybody knew it was supposed to exist, but it doesn't really exist.
Yeah,
that's another one. It's like those weird things, and then you get on the internet and suddenly it's all in the games, all these weird things that are supposed to be, we were so sure of, but it's like it doesn't actually exist, it's not in there. But after that, I didn't have the motivation to keep going, and I don't think I ever even finished the first disc.
Yeah, I got a little bit farther, but I mean, yeah, you gotta remember, this game came out in 1997, so
right.
we're a good 23 years later now,
yeah.
if my math serves me well.
Yeah,
you know, so my memories of playing the game are pretty solid. I remember the fact that it was turn-based, so it's like, all right, I'm getting whacked. Well, I better hope that my wingman can kill this enemy because this guy's on his deathbed. I better hope that this chick can have a quick enough attack bar so where I can shoot a potion over to this guy. I mean, it was really random. And like you said, the randomness of the battles started to get a little bit irritating. And because after a while, it's like, all right, I want to advance the story. I want to know what happens. Well, here we go. I got to fight 27 more dragons now. And really, it's not going to give you anything other than some gratuitous XP to level up that you don't really need to level up. Yeah. Although the worst, I think the worst RPG of all time was on the Sega Dreamcast called Skies of Arcadia, which was an awesome RPG. It was a really, really good RPG. I think I put 80-some hours into it. I beat it. However, it was another one with the random battles. But by the end of the game, the random battles were coming like literally every 18 seconds. So you couldn't walk across the room without getting into another battle. And that just got so irritating. But, you know, I dug my heels and I'm like, you know what? I already put 80 hours into this stinking game. I want to see the credits.
Yeah.
I want to know who the lead audio programmer was, right, for God's sakes.
And God bless anybody who loves that type of game. All the power to you. Enjoy it. That's what the game is for. Enjoyment, have fun. It's just not quite my thing. And I'm one of the type of people that, you know, I used to play things on easy, but I like to do it on normal because I do like a challenge. But I like when easy says something, like, choose this option if you like to more experience the story. And I'm like, that is kind of me. I go in there, I want to experience the story of these games. The stories in games have gotten so compelling. And when you look at stuff like The Last of Us, The Last of Us, that make you cry within 5 minutes of playing it. I mean,
that opening sequence, it kind of hits you in the feels a little bit, doesn't it?
Oh yes, I mean, it's like watching a Pixar movie. You're gonna be a mess.
Except instead of having dead parents, now you have a dead kid.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry, spoilers.
If you haven't played The Last of Us by now, then you deserve to have it spoiled.
Yeah, but the compelling narratives they're putting into games, I mean, it's amazing. Yeah. And I do want to, before we get into talking about the remake, I do want to give a little bit of credit to, you know, the funny thing with Final Fantasy, and people like to make this joke all the time, is like, there's numbers in this series. How can it be the Final Fantasy if we're up to, there's actually 15 of these games now? The fun part is, so you had, and I'm probably going to butcher his name, Hironobu Sakaguchi. He worked for formerly Square or Squaresoft before it became Square Enix. They were losing money. He thought this was going to be the last game I ever get to make. It was going to be his Final Fantasy. And so he's like, you know what? And it was almost like Stan Lee. Stan Lee, when he put out the Fantastic Four, he did it because he thought, well, there, you know, I'm probably not long for this business. And his wife had told him, you know what? Just make the book that you want to make and just do whatever. And then suddenly, boom, the Fantastic Four launched something new. And so he was able to try again with doing things differently. And that's what this was. It's like, well, you know what? I'm going to make the game that I want to make, and I'm going to just put it out there. And next thing you know, it's selling huge, so the Final Fantasy became not so final. Although each game has been different scenarios, almost a different world. There's a few things that are always common, like chocobos, and there's always usually a Biggs and a Wedge in there somewhere.
You know, I picked up on that when I started playing the remake. I'm like, you know, somebody's a Star Wars fan here.
Mm-hmm.
Because I remembered Kate Sith, you know, because, you know, you don't see the word Sith a whole often in nature. But then I picked up on a Biggs and Wedge. I'm like, you know, somebody's got a little bit of George Lucas fanboy going on here.
Oh, yeah. And I've heard some people pronounce that character as Cat She. I'm like, why would you call it Cat She when clearly when you look at it, it says Kate Sith.
Correct.
So I'll see how when they pronounce it when that character shows up more in the game. I did see that because that character is a two part character. There's two people together, two creatures, and I did see half of that person show up in the remake already. They're hinting at, oh yeah, there's other people going to be around. So, but now we've got like you said, 23 years later, and the Final Fantasy VII is still, it created iconic characters. We all remember Cloud Strife, which, you know, before we would read his, you know, dialogue. We didn't have voice acting in there. So he sounded like however we wanted him to sound, you know.
Yes.
So, but all the characters, you know, they became icons, and they are the most, almost as recognizable as Mario at this point. So much to where there was even, I think they were straight to video. They might have been theatrical releases, but we had Advent Children, an animated movie based on Final Fantasy VII, like a sequel.
I actually saw that.
I saw it, but I didn't understand all of it because I hadn't finished the game, so I didn't know what was going on. But I was like, wow, this looks amazing.
It's a lousy movie, but it's got good graphics. Wow.
Yeah, and to think of how good that looked, now we've got a game that looks better than that movie did.
Oh my god, the graphics on Remake.
Oh my goodness.
They blew me away how good they are. It looks like Pixar CG in real time.
Except for the characters are a bit more realistic than your average Pixar.
Yeah. I mean, they still have their weird, you know, JRPG movements, like the body movements don't exactly read what
right.
exactly they're saying, especially some of the Tifa's dialogue sequences. You know, she'll say something, then she'll do this weird body contortion thing.
She'll do that
out of nowhere.
Peace sign pose from a Japan anime. Ta-da!
It's like, wait a minute, you just told me somebody died. Why are you peeing me?
Ta-da! Yeah.
But my gosh, the quality of the graphics and the amount of the polygons in these things, like where you can start counting their individual strands of hair, literally.
And see the textures in the skin now.
Counting the pores on their face, like holy smoke, rollies.
And even when you get up close, I noticed it where I'm at now in the game, there was a bit of close up. You saw Aerith kind of walking by, and you can see in her dress, texture in the dress, like patterns and designs in the texture. I'm like, oh my goodness.
Yeah, or like the individual stitching in the ribs and Cloud's sweater. It's like, yes. If this is the gold standard for graphics, what's going to happen in November when the PS5 comes out? Or, you know, like, what more can you do to me?
Photorealism.
And which, we're getting there, my dude.
Which frightens me with what they can do with photorealism because, you know, as I've mentioned, I'm a Resident Evil fan. Although I don't like horror movies, but I like Resident Evil games.
I'm with you, dude. I've never seen a single horror movie. I've never seen a Freddy movie. I've never seen a Jason movie. I guess I'm just not interested in watching some girl get hacked into 1,000 pieces with a blood-curdling scream. I can go to work if I want to see that.
Yeah, but like with Resident Evil 7, the photorealism in that just intensified everything. Something, you know, I don't have a VR setup, but oh my goodness, that must have been nightmare inducing for anybody who, you know, at this point I'd know what was coming, so playing in VR would still be cool, but it wouldn't be as frightening because I'd know what was coming. But
sure,
I can imagine the first time you played it was still, you were doing the VR, oh my goodness.
Yeah, it would mess you up a little bit.
Yeah.
I mean, just even on the TV, that opening, that scene toward the beginning where you get knocked out, then you come to and you sit at the table with all that disgusting food being shoved in. Can you imagine that? Imagine that with a VR helmet on. And I have the PlayStation VR. I've had it pretty much since it came out. It's cool, man. There's a couple really cool games on that. I can't imagine some of that stuff in, you know, right up in your face in 3D, man.
It was almost perfectly photorealistic, that game. It was amazing. And to see how far we've come, and now with the recent release, like I said, the Final Fantasy Remake and how good it looks, but also the way that they've able to step up from what they were able to do 23 years ago, and now the characters have full voices. I got to credit the actors. I think they've done a phenomenal job with these characters of bringing them to life. The music it's still the same music from, let me find this guy's name. It's really hard to say the guy's name, but he's done Final Fantasy music for pretty much, I think, if not all of the games, most of them. But to have taken his music and now it's fully orchestrated, it is, I mean, I went ahead, I pre-ordered that deluxe edition just to get that mini soundtrack that I got.
Really?
Plus, I got a really good, book I can show you on camera. Here, the package here that I got. But it came with a mini soundtrack. It came with a little book that shows how they were redesigning the characters. I mean, this is a big, nice, thick package. It even came with a nice steelbook case that I was able to move the game discs into. So it's got a steelbook. Oh, I noticed, put up the camera.
And notice you said game discs.
Two discs.
This game is so big, you have an install disc, and then you have the play disc.
Yeah, on a PlayStation.
So you guys tuning in here, you best be clearing some space on the old hard drive, because you're going to need a good solid chunk of it.
Yeah, and especially because I have been making videos. Yeah, here's like the book that came with it. So those who are on Patreon getting to see the video, you'll be able to see this with Tim. It's getting dark in my room. I probably should have turned on my office light, but I was using the natural light from my window. But it's got all these designs of like different locations and stuff. I mean, this is a really nice little booklet.
You can see the art quality is pretty strong.
It's amazing what they can do these days. Oh, and I think I just
Why didn't we think of this?
Yeah, it's, I wouldn't have thought when I was a little kid playing the Atari down in the basement of the house with him when I was like 6 years old that I would ever see a game to this scale that have this much story. That I mean, the original Final Fantasy VII, I think, is the first time I had heard of a game actually making people cry. With an event that I mentioned earlier.
I mean, River Raid on the old Atari used to make me cry because it was so damn hard by the time you got to the end of it. But then again, I may or may not have been like 8 years old or 9 years old or something. So, you know.
Well, I'm talking, of course, with the story and getting characters that were that compelling. And now, because even when I've talked to my wife about different things in the game, she sees the emotion in my eyes because you get attached to these characters. These characters become your friends as you're playing this. And there are some side characters that they aren't going to make it through the entire game. And it's sad to watch them go when something happens. You get attached to them. Just like you would maybe in any movie. Because a good movie, you get attached to those characters sometimes. A really good movie. Like when Disney is on point, you get attached to those characters. And you become huge fans of those characters. Next thing you know, you're wearing shirts with those characters. They're on your walls. I mean, my master bedroom, I have Ariel stuff all over the place because she's still my favorite Disney princess. So you get attached to characters. And it's kind of reminds me, like Harry Potter. Everybody got attached to a lot of those characters in Harry Potter. And when you get to that seventh book, not all of those characters made it out alive, but it affects you. And you know,
all the dead ones ended up in Game of Thrones anyway, so it's all good.
Well, yeah, in the movies, but in the books, you know. So,
so you're is it safe to say that Admiral Holdo didn't do it for you?
I'm sorry, no. And I do love Laura Dern, mainly from Jurassic Park, but yeah, that's the. Some of the classic Star Wars characters, though, you know, those we got very attached to Luke and Han and Leia, definitely, and Chewie, of course. But I don't.
To get completely hijacked here, when I went and saw Rise of Skywalker on opening night, and I had my wife and kids with me, I had to check my breathing a couple times because I wasn't going to have them look over, and see this 43-year-old dude like getting all weepy eyed because Leia didn't make it. Well, and that's not a spoiler alert. I mean, she passed away in real life. Suffice to say, she's probably not going to make it through to the end. But, it's like, who are you going to take away? You already took away Han in episode 7. You took away Luke in episode 8. episode 8. Where is this going to go? I know Rise of Skywalker was a little bit divisive on the internet. I loved it. I thought it was good.
I had fun.
I love the fact that they retconned episode 8. I'm okay with that. Yeah. Episode 8, you ruined my Star Wars, dude. I like the fact that they retconned it and cleaned up a lot of things. I thought it was really cool that they brought Palpatine back, even though it made no sense at all, that this dead dude's not dead, sort of, kind of, in a way, not really, maybe. But you know what? I don't go to Star Wars to think. I go to Star Wars to watch stuff blow up really cool with fancy graphics, maybe have a little bit of fun along the way. And you know what? I kind of dug Rey. I thought she was a cool character. Yeah. She did well.
And she became a lot better in this last movie, too.
Yeah, she was pretty hardcore.
Yeah. So definitely it was an improvement.
But like you said, you get attached to these characters. I grew up playing with the little Kenner toys of Luke and Han and Obi-Wan and having fake lightsaber fights. In my parents' backyard and all this kind of crazy stuff. So, yeah, you're right. I mean, I don't know that I've quite... Oh, boy, here we go.
I got a little toy lightsaber here.
I don't know that I've quite gotten that far attached to video games, especially now that I'm older. But you know what? I hear what you're saying because, there is that school of thought that video games are interactive art.
Yeah.
Interactive drama. I mean, heck, Quantic Dreams has made a career off of calling themselves interactive art, I believe. Heavy Rain and Beyond Two Souls, or I think that was Quantic Dreams, right?
Probably was. Anything that's more narrative and you're just interacting with it and playing out the story by minor actions. I haven't played through any of their games, although I'm very interested in that Detroit Become Human. That looks very cool and very kind of Blade Runner.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. So,
They're also basically like Heavy Rain. Cool game, really cool story. I didn't finish it, but it was pretty neat. But really, it's just giant. It's basically one giant QuickTime event. I mean, if you think about it, it is. But then again, some of the best games were, you know, was it Space Ace with the, you know, the old LaserDisc game there? It was a giant
Dragon's Lair.
But it was like, yeah, Dragon's Lair. It was, but they were cool games.
Yeah.
You know, so there's something for everybody in the medium. But, you know, I don't quite get so attached to the video game characters as you do, but I can understand where and appreciate where you're coming from on that.
And especially in this one, the characters are just so much better. I mean, they took, and I was saying this before we started recording, it's like they took the characters that were pretty cool in the original, and they amped them up by 11. Because now they have voices, they're able to show more personality, we can see expressions on their faces, we spend time. And part of what's been neat about the remake is we see Cloud, who comes into this as kind of this stone-cold mercenary. And we see him slowly open up and actually become friends with these other characters, and we feel like they're becoming our friends too. And so you feel it sometimes when you're in a battle and one of them gets knocked down, you get a little mad at whatever character knocked him down. Like, doggone it, you are not taking them out of the fight. So you throw out a phoenix down and like, they're back. You know, come on, let's take this thing down. You know, you're rallying your troops. And that's one of the things I love.
I'd like to borrow Barrett's arm every once in a while. Usually when I'm in traffic.
Yeah, suck on this. You know, oh, yes.
Yeah, dude, they made Barrett pretty hardcore, didn't they?
Yes. He's funnier now, too. He gets some really great lines.
Yeah, I mean, you have to listen pretty close to this one, because there's a lot of dialogue that's kind of off the beaten track, and, like, it doesn't show up in the little subtitles, because it's just kind of... they're just kind of lines being said in the background, but if you pick up on them, they're pretty funny.
Yeah, even if you walk past other people in the background, I've turned on all subtitles at this point, because I don't know if the sound was mixed as well as it could have, because they're trying to, I think, do relative distance. So if you've walked a little too far away from Barrett and he's saying something, you might not necessarily hear it. I even had one point where the dialogue that was going on around me was being overshadowed by all the crowd of people that were around us. So I couldn't hear the main dialogue, so I started having to rely on the subtitles to know what was happening on in the actual narrative that I was involved in. So
there's some good NPC one-liners as you're walking around. Like, oh, yeah. You never know what these people are going to say to you.
Right. But it is neat to see the effect, the main characters, what the effects are they're having in the world and the environment they're walking around in.
Yeah.
Because you've basically got like a sort of a tyrannical dictator communist government masquerading themselves as a corporation. But they're also the ones controlling the media. Sounds a little bit familiar. So the media is lying for this certain particular type of government and giving a narrative which is mixed a little bit of truth, but also a heavy amount of lie. But everybody trusts this media. And so they'll just take that as truth when they're being flat out lied to. And I found that
kind of like art imitating life, right?
Yes. That's one of the things I found very, very interesting is we do see, you know, like you really can't take the media at face value. And sometimes you really need to go and check. The nice thing about our world is we have more than one media source. So you can check a lot of different ones and compile the actual truth by going to multiple media sources instead of relying on just one. And in the Final Fantasy world in Midgar, there's one media and it's controlled completely by the ruling person who it's masquerade. Like I said, I call them they masquerade as a corporation and an energy company, but they're the ones ruling. They built this city. At one point, you will meet the so-called mayor, but he complains that he has nothing to do. They says, I'm a librarian. They call me the mayor, but I'm a librarian. The king of this place is the guy running Shinra, you know.
President Shinra.
President Shinra. Oh, yes. So it's a very interesting type of setup you've got going on. And so you're like this underground group where you're like, we're the only ones that seem to actually know what really happened. But in some cases with the remake, they've really enhanced some stuff to where they don't even know what happened. Like that first Mako reactor, they think they did it. They didn't do it. We'll just say that. You get to see this whole scene play out where there's like this whole other counter narrative. So your villains are more evil. But of course, it all centers around the king bad guy himself, Sephiroth, which they gave him a lot more presence in this, what's going to be, I guess, the first chapter in I don't know how many games to bring Final Fantasy VII back. Because, I mean, I've now spent as much time in this one game just doing a portion of the full story as it would have taken to maybe go through the full four disc game back in 1997. Because there's that much more.
Yeah. Well, they said Final Fantasy VII Remake is a really fully padded out narrative of just the Midgar sequence, mm-hmm. which was, 3 or 4 hours maybe in the original?
Mm-hmm.
You come, you do, you leave. But this one, like you said, there's some weight to the story in going through Midgar. Like, you see people on the down and out. You see people struggling, but then you see people that are making the best of a bad situation and, you know, finding a way to survive. So there's definitely a little bit of, you know, maybe some light political commentary in there, if you choose to look at it as such.
Yeah.
But at the same time,
from a Japan point of view,
yeah, which, you know, we're in some strange times right now, as you know.
Yeah.
But but if you really take the time to look at it, there's a lot of stuff going on just in Midgar. You know, yeah. you have the almost Death Star type corridors of the up in the Mako reactors. Then you've got the slums where people down there have absolutely nothing and they're still finding a way to stay happy.
Yeah.
And pretty much everything in between, you know. You've got Canto Bite, Wall Market.
Yeah.
There's a lot going on. It's a really well done game, and the art direction is fantastic.
Amazing.
And frankly, I think the voice acting adds another layer to it too. You couldn't pull this off without the voice acting.
Right.
You know, sitting there reading stuff to your head, you know, reading stuff to yourself and, you know, creating your own voices in your head, it doesn't do it, you know. And thankfully, this is 2020, you know, AAA level voice acting. This isn't, you know, going back to your
Resident Evil.
Resident Evil. Yes, you know, Jeremy, the king of unlocking.
Right. I was almost a Jeremy sandwich.
Yeah. Pow, 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 pow. Oh, that sounded like a gunshot. I should go and check. It's laughably bad, you know, and it was bad then. Yeah. I mean, now it's
still charming to me just because of the nostalgia of, because I remembering playing the original Resident Evil, being just absolutely terrified by it. It's still got a charm of being the bad voice acting, so I still appreciate it.
All right, so yes or no, should they remake Resident Evil 1 in the vein of the 2 and 3 remakes?
I would like to see them do that. I mean, because I liked what they did with the HD and the remake they did with Resident Evil. That was really neat. But to see
the GameCube remake was fantastic.
Yeah.
At the time, and now you got to go back. What are we going back? Almost 20 years there, too. Maybe 50, you know.
Yeah, because that was, I think it was 95, 96 when Resident Evil.
Yeah, so you're probably talking, you know, 2000-ish, somewhere thereabouts. I mean, well, I'm sure
when they did that remake, yeah.
You know, I mean, that was the gold standard back then. Mm-hmm. This is how you remake a game and make it into something great. And it really wasn't that old when they remade it, but they really did a nice job with that. I would love to see what they did with Resident Evil 2 remake.
It's great.
And by extension, 3.
Yeah.
It was fantastic. You know, do that back to the OG Resident Evil.
Yeah.
And do that before you remake Resident Evil 4, because now there's rumors circulating that they're going to redo 4.
It's announced, Resident Evil 4, which I don't think they need to touch Resident Evil 4. I think that one's fine the way it was.
It didn't age great. And the reason
the controls are a little rough now.
Yeah, you can't move and aim at the same time, so you have to do that whole thing where you run away and then press down and X to do a quick turn and then get up on your target. So there's some rough edges that can be updated on it and smoothed out. But I would rather see 1 remade before 4.
Yeah, and I'd rather just see an update to 4 instead of a complete remake, because I think probably is my favorite of the regular. Although the remake of Resident Evil 2 is kind of like my new favorite, because that was so great.
All right, here we go. And here we go. Another, you know, true confession time here. I really liked 5. I really did. Yeah.
I played through it once and I was like, this, what did they do? They dropped the ball. I mean, it's kind of a neat for an action game. And I imagine it would be a lot more fun if you are playing as 2 player. That would be fun. Yeah. you know, doing the cooperative.
Yeah, but I just thought it was cool, and I beat it a bunch of times, and yeah, now I'm so OP going through it because I'm all jacked out now, so you know, I can just go through and just blast everybody away with two or three shots. Yeah. So kind of some of the challenge is gone.
That's the way I am now with on GameCube version of Resident Evil 4 because I've got the infinite rocket launcher, so I just go blam.
Well, that was four had the Chicago typewriter, right? It was the Tommy gun with unlimited ammo.
I think that was Resident Evil 2. I know they've brought that, I think, in the remake, but I don't remember in 4 that I had a Tommy gun because I've got an infinite rocket launcher and I just blow everything up.
Well, four is the one with the creepy vendor guy that keeps showing up, yeah. Right? Like
he opens up some nice things for you.
What are you buying?
Yeah.
It's like some creepy dude pulled his trench coat open and just happened to have a
I'm carrying arsenal. All kinds of guns in my coat.
And I'm just going to happen to show up at random places out of nowhere. But yeah, I think that's the one where you can get like a Tommy gun with unlimited ammo. You just go through and just start plinking things away. So it kind of takes some of the spook away from it, but it's still, right. it's still a cool game.
It's still a great one. So I need to replay because they now that I could get some gamer points on my PlayStation for it, I'm thinking maybe I should go back and replay it. But I think I on the PlayStation Plus, I tried to replay it, and that's when I started feeling how the controls are a little dated compared to how we control a game like that now. And I was like, well, this for some reason it feels awkward now.
And it still looks decent, though.
It still looks great. And I remember when we first got a look at it when they were announcing it, I was like, oh my goodness, look at this.
Yeah. So. And then we have, you know, you have the debacle of 6 that didn't know what game it wanted to be. So let's make it 4. We'll just make 4 games out of it.
Yeah, I only played a demo of 6, and I was like, I don't know what you guys did, but I'm actually not interested in a Resident Evil game. What'd you do?
That one, yeah. I started playing it again just to play it again, just for the sake of playing it again. I was getting aggravated, and then Final Fantasy came out, so it's all good now.
Yeah. Which was focal point.
You like the way I circled back around there?
Circle back around. Now, but here's the thing, because, all right, so this is a Disney show, so generally we talk Disney, right? And occasionally we go outside of Disney. But did I really go outside of Disney? No, I did not. Square is also famous for making Kingdom Hearts, which features all kinds of fantastic Disney characters. And alongside those Disney characters, you will find Final Fantasy characters, including Aerith. Pops up in several of the Kingdom Hearts games, helping out there with Mickey, Donald, well, mainly Donald and Goofy. She's helping you out. And in fact, I don't know if in the original Kingdom Hearts, but I know the HD remake, which I still haven't finished, there is an arena with Hercules that you can go through. The final tournament battle you can have is with Sephiroth himself, which I hear is extremely difficult, which I'm having a hard time with him actually right now in the remake as well. That's where I'm at. By the time this comes out, hopefully I will have defeated Sephiroth and completed the remake, but wow, he kicked my can. As you know, it's a typical Japan anime final boss character who's got a god complex. They can almost back it up, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, he's a little bit of a pain in the butt.
Yeah, a little bit. He was a lot of pain in the butt. Woo! But yeah, see, so you got the Kingdom Hearts connection, which, if Kingdom Hearts 3 plays anything like what this is, because I love the combat system now in the Final Fantasy VII remake, but Kingdom Hearts 3, you know, the original Kingdom Hearts is definitely more an action-oriented. The frustration I've had with that one is, When I can't find something that I need to get into the next area, every time you enter a room, all the enemies regenerate and you cannot leave until you've killed everything in that room. And I'm having the same problems I had with the original Final Fantasy VII playthrough that, like, dang it, I'm trying to advance the story and I keep having to stop for all these battles constantly. I'm like, can I just go in through this area here? Because I just want to pass through, but it won't let me because there's enemies in the vicinity. And that's been driving me crazy. And I got so far where I'm fighting Ursula in Kingdom Hearts, and it was so frustrating, I couldn't find what I needed in the Little Mermaid world, that by the time I got to Ursula and I lost the boss fight, I was like, okay, I need to step away from this for a while, and I just haven't stepped back, because I'm a polygamous gamer. If I kind of get stuck in one game, I'm going to end up wandering over and finding something else that will end up holding my interest for a while, until I maybe get stuck on that one or I finish it. Or if I just, like, I have a friend who wants to play something else, and like, oh, well, hey, I'll come and play this on the computer with you. So I have now started in a lot of different games, like, you know, Diablo 3, I've still never finished, Borderlands 2, the original Borderlands, lots of games that I've played with other people, but I've never actually finished the main story because the people I'm playing with, hey, we feel like playing this today. Okay, well, let's play that then.
You know how many times I sit down, I'm like, you know what, I'm going to play this game, I'm going to finish it, I'm going to start working on my backlog of discs that's probably about, you know, this big by now. You know, I've got stuff from Christmas 2 and 3 years ago that still has the plastic on it because, yeah, you know, because it's like, you know, hey, look, shiny objects. Hey, look.
Yeah. Dragon Age Origins for both the PS3 and, because it was on sale digitally on the PS4 for like $2. I've got Dragon Age Origins been sitting there and I still haven't even touched it. But I hear it's great, and it's a BioWare, and, you know, after Mass Effect, not to mention Knights of the Old Republic, the BioWare made. I got to try this. It's a BioWare game.
I still have the plastic on Bloodborne. I mean, I remember getting that years ago for Christmas. It's still on it. But then every time I go to look, I look it up. I'm like, you know, this looks pretty cool. And they're like, oh, this game's really hard. I'm like, yeah, well, I don't feel like getting annoyed tonight. So I'm going to go play Lego Harry Potter or something.
That's actually kind of what happened to me with Jedi Fallen Order, is I've got this boss fight that I just cannot master. But it's such a great game. But, oh, man, I got stuck with the Ninth Sister. And
it does feel like you're playing inside of a Star Wars world. Like it's very authentic and genuine. They did a nice job with it, but damn, it's hard.
Yeah. But when I hit that hard point, that's where I'm kind of like, okay, I need to take a break from this and step away. And oh, you know what? I have never finished playing this game. Or sometimes it's just the games that I love so much that I'm like, you know what? I think I need to play through this again. Like Spider-Man, I've played through that thing so many times now. Or Batman Arkham Asylum, I've played through that one. I can't even count. Or even the Uncharted series. Sometimes you just, I'm not one of those people that, because I've known people that are like it, they'll play through a game once and they'll go and trade it in to get something else. If I really like it, I keep it. And I'm going to play through it again and again, like rewatching a great movie.
Sure.
And that's the thing, when I finish the remake of Final Fantasy VII, I guarantee you, I'm going to find other things to do with it. Because I haven't done everything yet. I'm going to keep playing this thing because I am just sucked in and I will be sad to see it end. Although I must say, when you get close to the end, it's going to feel a little Lord of the Rings, like, oh, this must be the end of the game. We're going to branch off to the next. No, I'm not done. Oh, okay. Well, that felt like the final boss. Okay, cool. I beat that final boss. Am I done? Oh, look, another final boss. I have fought at least 5 final bosses in a row. But now, yeah, well, you know, on Sephiroth, but, I'm like, oh.
Yeah, well, you never know. There might be some little girl that wants you to go find her 5 lost kittens again or something. Like, yeah, some of the little side missions are a little strange. They're a little out of place, but they're still
I love
fun.
Side missions, though.
I do, too.
That's how I never got through Skyrim. I got so bogged down in side missions that I forgot what I was even doing. I'm going to have to start over.
You know, like I mentioned earlier, Witcher 3. Apparently, that's like the goddad. That's like the granddaddy of games with great side missions. Apparently, from what I've been told,
you can usually wrap those up fairly quickly because you'll have a side mission. You're just taking a contract to go hunt a monster, and it's kind of fun because you go and try to track, figure out what kind of monster it is, figure out what you need to kind of immune yourself to whatever evil things they can do to you, and then go kill it, and then come back and collect your reward. Oh my gosh, I loved playing through that game. I can't give it the full Neverland endorsement because holy cow, is their language. And nudity and all kinds of stuff. But I did really have a good time with that one. And there's probably stuff in that game I haven't done that I just never found the side mission.
There's some dialogue in Final Fantasy VII Remake that you may or may not want to play with your parents.
At least it's more PG-13.
Yeah.
So it's definitely kept more, instead of doing a hard R like The Witcher is. Holy cow, there's words I didn't think I'd ever hear in a video game. And that is actually one complaint I have about the modern video game world, is we get a lot more mature games. And mature just used to mean that, well, you're going to have some, there's going to be some blood and a little bit of violence in here, so we're going to rate it mature. But now it's gone so far that we're even, there's people who I'm sure love the new Mortal Kombat games, but it seems like the level of graphic violence has gotten more. If I wanted to watch that, I'd go watch a Friday the 13th movie, but I'm not into those. And I don't want a game that has that level of violence. So Mortal Kombat, I can't get into what Nether Realms has done. Although I've played a little bit, and it's a great game mechanic, but I've seen the fatalities, and they're horrible to watch, and I just don't like that. And so, like, the language, the level of violence has, unfortunately, gone up. And it is nice to have Final Fantasy VII Remake because there was some language in the original. It was censored into like comical little symbols like Qbert. Now they flat out can say stuff.
I remember that. Yeah. I forgot about that.
They'd cuss, but it was in text, and you know, they would just, like in a comic book, you'd have like the symbols. And so this, I do appreciate it's more PG-13, and no one has dropped an F-bomb in this. So I still feel like I can talk about, because we've talked about some PG-13 movies because Marvel and now Star Wars. So,
you know, it's funny. I was watching the Blu-ray of Rise of Skywalker with my daughter the other night, and she's 6.5, and you know, posted a couple light swear words by comparison, and she looked at me like I had two heads. She goes, "I can't believe he said that, Daddy." I'm like, he's a grown up. He can get away with it.
Yeah. Although that is very different because, like, the original movies, the worst thing we heard was from Han Solo, "I'll see you in hell." That's the worst bit of language they had. Now,
who
comparing
you
that.
Call course, scruffy?
Yeah. There wasn't that. So that was kind of a odd thing for Star Wars to go that way. But what is more odd is if you watch some of the Picard series, some of the language that's been dropped in that, which is very outside of Star Trek. Especially considering in Star Trek IV, we had a whole conversation about that in their time, they've gotten rid of profanities because they realized it wasn't useful for anything. But we really need to wrap this up here. So believe me, I could chase some rabbits and tangent all over the place.
Oh, yeah.
So I didn't even get a chance to go into some of the depth of some of these characters, but just suffice to say, the characters are great in the whole Final Fantasy area of games.
Yeah.
Some of the best characters, you will get attached if you're capable of getting attached to video game characters, and I am. So
yeah, apparently, now that we've established that I'm just a cold hearted, you know, jerk. Apparently,
I have wondered in the remake if there will be a chance to alter fate, because it seems to be a theme here in the game. There's these things called whispers, and as I've gotten towards the end, there seems to be a big theme of altering our destiny.
Are you talking about the Dementors?
Yeah, they look like Dementors, which I don't recall them being in the original game at all. But there's this theme of altering destiny, which makes me think that they're going to try to do things. We're like, oh yeah, because they're making stuff for new fans and old fans alike, in my opinion. And so they're trying to give some of the old fans, like, here's everything you loved about Final Fantasy VII, but guess what? We can do it differently now. This will be almost like an alternate reality because they've done something here that has altered their fate.
That would be cool, wouldn't it?
So hopefully something bad is not going to happen, because I am committed to playing through these games, and if something bad still happens to my favorite character, I'm going to sit here and cry right here in my office as I'm playing this game. My wife's going to look at me like I'm nuts.
She does it anyway.
Well, yeah.
So, but you'll vindicate her this time.
But I will vindicate her. It's like, doggone it, they killed off this character. And I don't want to say names, and I don't want to spoil for anyone who doesn't know. But it's not hard to go online and find out of this. It was an event within the game. This shook the gaming world when this happened. And you can find articles in old gaming magazines. And even when I was doing research for this episode, which I haven't hardly used all the research I used. That was one of the most significant and ranked as one of the top most significant and cinematic moments ever in a game, is when this event happens, which I hope we can alter, because this game has a theme, like I said, of redefining our destiny and choosing our destiny and our fate. And it reminds me a lot of The Matrix and Terminator 2. No fate, but that what we make for ourselves. So I highly recommend this game. You got to go out and get it and go find the music. Because if you love orchestrated music or film soundtracks, this mini soundtrack that came with the deluxe edition, I love it. It is so good.
It really is good. It is. Yeah. And you know, everybody remembers the little victory montage. Yeah, and they actually make fun of themselves inside the game at one point, which is pretty cool. But like you said, you know, you went from these, you know, primitive CD, barely better than chiptune soundtracks from 1997. Now it's almost like you have the John Williams Orchestra out there. Yeah. You know, and it does sound different, but there's still enough familiar motifs within the music that you pick up the familiar strains from many years ago. It's like you said, it was really
plussed. It was what we Disney fans say. It's been plussed.
not all remakes are created equal. Not that, you know, but this is one of those cases where everything old is new again. But this was masterfully executed. I haven't played it in a couple days because I've been busy with some other commitments that I've had to do, but you know, I've sat down at 6 o'clock at night, and next thing I look at the clock, it's like 11:30. I'm like, what the heck happened?
Yeah, that definitely happened to me yesterday.
Yeah, I asked my wife, where's the kids? She's like, oh, they've been sleeping for 3 hours, dude. You know, if you get off your PlayStation, I'm like, yeah, all right, good point.
Okay.
This is a tour de force, and I think I read somewhere on one of the gaming blogs or whatever that it's either going to be a 2 or 3 part series to finish the game off, because, you know, 7 remake that's out now basically took care of a lot of the takes care of a lot of the expositional type stuff. So now we know who the characters are. They're reintroduced. Their motivations are made clear. They're humanized. Mm-hmm. So now the path is paved for this thing to go open up into the rest of the world and carry out the rest of the story. So if they make a 3-parter out of it, great. I mean, I hope it doesn't go more than that, because after, you know, because then you'll start to get, you know, fatigue with the game. But I could see it being a 3-part, kind of like an Ezio arc from Assassin's Creed, where, you know, he had his 3-parter, and they moved on.
Plus, there's more characters to meet still yet.
There's a lot going on. I mean, you know, I know we've kind of gone on every tangent here and there and everything, but you know, we're also trying to be sensitive to not spoil the story for some of the newcomers. I mean, you know, and I'm considering myself a newcomer to Final Fantasy VII. It's been so long since I played the original,
right.
And my memory is so foggy about it. I'm like, you know, I might be remembering things I never even saw before, you know, within the remake story. They did change a lot of things. But, you know, it's as much of a video game as it's an experience. Like,
yeah.
it does have a little bit of weight to it. And the characters have gravitas. And, you know, it's something to be seen. And, you know, for those at home listening that are kind of thinking, you know, maybe I'm not really going to like this. I'm not into role-playing games. I don't care about leveling up and grinding out, you know, potions and items. That's almost ancillary to the story and the art direction and just the overall quality of it, you know. You don't have to spend all your time doing meaningless nonsense, just go around breaking boxes just because they're there, even though you break boxes because they're there. It doesn't feel like a chore. It doesn't feel like, oh jeez, getting through this. Like, you wanna know what happened. Like you said, you wanna know what happens. You wanna advance the story, you wanna get moving. Just because it's like, wow, look how good visually this one section looks. I can't imagine what's gonna come around the corner when we jump into the next chapter or something like that. So this is a pretty solid piece of art they came up with.
Yeah. But we really got to wrap because we're over an hour. So thanks for joining me again here, Tim.
Yeah, man. Always a pleasure. All you got to do is ask, buddy.
Oh, yeah. We need to do more often because we got to talk some more games. Especially,
I could talk PlayStation with you.
Oh, yeah. Especially game soundtracks is this idea I've had for a long time because... There's some really iconic music out there to some of these games. But, all right, so everybody make sure you go to Divine Image Works or The Magic and Pixels. Come check out Tim's stuff. Especially if you have a graduating student, he's got something on Divine Image Works right now that you're going to want for your student.
Thank you for listening to the Neverland Podcast.
We invite you back next week for more fun and adventure.
Until then, remember to keep a pixie in your pocket.
It's that young at heart, positive attitude that you can share with others.
And remember to visit our website at neverlandpodcast.com.
There you can find links to our news page, our shop,
our contact page, where you can easily send an email to podcast@neverlandpodcast.com.
You can also find our Neverlanders page, where you can find out how to become an official Lost Boy or Pixie, because girls are too clever to get lost.
Become a real Neverlander.
Please feel free to leave us a voicemail at 816-226-6492.
And be sure to follow us on Twitter at NeverlandPCast.
And like our Neverland Podcast fan page on Facebook.
We also have a group on Facebook for you to join.
We also appreciate your support to keep the Neverland Podcast up and running.
Visit patreon.com/neverlandpodcast to donate to keeping the pixie dust alive.
Copyright content featured on the Neverland Podcast is copyright of their respective creators and used under fair use license.
All original content is copyright of Blue Band Productions And a very special thanks to Yeehaw Bob Jackson at yeehawbob.com for our new ending music.
God bless!
Yeah! Hello, everybody. This is Yeehaw Bob Jackson. Neverland Podcast, we love you. Neverland Podcast, we love you. Neverland Podcast, it's true.